Welcome to The Front Porch, a program dedicated to turning back the pages of time and discovering the rich history and culture of our Northeast Georgia area. Join us now with your host, local historian and writer, Bobby Watson, and this week's special guest.
Well, hello, everyone. Welcome back to The Front Porch. My name is Bobby Watson. It has been a while since we have visited on The Front Porch, and I am happy that we're back post-COVID, and a lot of things have happened since we have been here on the set, but I'm glad that we're getting ready to start another series, and hopefully we'll have some fantastic guests coming up this fall and after the holiday season and into the spring, and let's just hope that things will settle down a little bit and we'll get a handle on this COVID pandemic that has hurt us so much. But in coming back today, one of my first guests that I just had to have is my dear friend and writer. I started to say fellow writer because I'm not a writer compared to this guy. This guy is really a writer. Number one, he knows how to spell. and number two, he has a brain that is really rather weird and funny at the same time. But I am just delighted to welcome back to the front porch here my good friend, Emory Jones.
Thank you, Bobby.
Emory, I am happy to have you here.
It's good to be here. I appreciate it very much.
I was just flipping here through one of your latest books, Helen 101, and I've read many of your books, but I have not read all of them because I have not read history, Helen 101. But we can talk about that, but mainly I want to catch up. How have you and Judy been doing?
We've been doing great. We use COVID as kind of a time to write and relax and everything, but I wanted to, I know you suffered a tragic loss during this period, and I wanted to give you my condolences on losing your wife, Susan.
Well, I appreciate that, Emory. I really appreciated you coming their funeral and being there. It meant a lot to me personally. And for those watching it, it has not been the best of years for me. My wife, Susan, we had been married just a few months short of 50 years, and the Lord took her home as a result of a heart attack. And Emory, she went quickly, she went peacefully, and even though she was way too young at 70.
Yeah.
But I tell you, she lived as she died, a quiet, peaceful passing. So thank you for me mentioning that. Yep. And sometime maybe later on, we'll talk a little bit more about her. She means an awful lot to me. But life goes on, and so we're happy to be here. But Emory, in this first segment, I wanted you to tell us just a little bit about the book here, Helen 101, because some of you may be watching this who are new to the county and new to Northeast Georgia. I notice quite often we have a real influx of people coming into Northeast Georgia.
Yep.
They're trying to learn about the history. Tell us a little bit about this book that you've written here, 101.
I will, but I got to comment on one thing you made. Okay. You said he's a really good speller. When my grandmother was in the church at Mossy Creek over at Cleveland, one time she was the oldest lady on Mother's Day, and they asked her what all she'd seen. You've seen the interstate system and the man on the moon and all that. And she got up and she said, yeah, I've seen all that, but the most fantastic, amazing thing I've ever seen in my life is that my grandson Emory can make a living writing as poorly as he spells.
Well, I tell you, I actually had the opportunity in the ninth grade at North Habersham High School in Clarksville to have my wife's oldest sister, Judy, who had just graduated college and was teaching for the first time, English, at North Habersham High School, probably in 66, 67, whenever that was. And I always kind of liked to write stories. And Judy made the comment, Miss King made the comment, she said, you will be able to write when typewriters spell. And absolutely, that is the truth.
Yeah.
And between my computer blaring at me when it's wrong, and other times when the word is so wrong the computer doesn't even know what to do about it, then I will ask Alexa, you know, how do I spell, you know, whatever the word is. I really could not never have been a writer.
Well, I keep my grandmother's big, thick dictionary that she bought me when I graduated from high school right on my desk, and I refer to it quite a bit.
Yeah.
I mean, spell check is not infallible. That's
oh,
for sure.
You're right. Oh, it's not. Yeah. How many times have I seen DEARs running through the woods? You know.
Yeah, but the Helen 101 book. Yeah, the reason it came about the first book I wrote was a little book with Shirley McDonald, a White County historian, called White County 101, and it was just a fun little book. It took about 3 days to write.
Yeah.
You know? But it went so well, and they sold them a lot up at one of the stores in Cleveland, and so one day I went up there and they were sold out, but they didn't order anymore. And I said, and there's stores in Helen, not Cleveland, but she said. I said, why you don't want any more of the books? She said, well, tourists, all the local people that want your book have got it.
Yeah.
The tourists don't know what county they're in. She said, think about when you travel.
Yeah, that's right.
If you're in Oklahoma and you hear a weather report, they say the tornado's bearing down on such and such county. You don't know, well, you know what town you're in,
right.
But you don't really know what county because you're not familiar with it. She said, if you wrote one called Helen 101, she said, I wouldn't be able to keep them on the shelf.
How about that?
Because they know they're in Helen. So that's the reason for that. Yeah. It took me about 6 or 7 years after that to get around to writing it.
Yeah.
But it's a neat little book. It tells the story of Helen right up front with John Colick.
I just noticed that. I don't know if you can see that or not, but the John, our friend, mutual friend, John Colick, dear friend of both of us. Nancy still is dear friend to us. And John probably had more to do with the soul of Northeast Georgia than anybody.
Yep, he wrote books, obviously, but he didn't tell his stories in writing as much as he did
in
his paintings. But he would take that each one of those pictures and make sure that it was entirely historically accurate. I know when he did one of the on the Tallulah Fall Railroad at one of the stations up at
Lakemont.
Tiger,
yeah, Lakemont.
Lakemont. Okay,
yeah.
one of the he took it up to show it to the people up there, and he had the sidetrack on the wrong side,
right.
So he went back and redid
the whole picture in order to accommodate that.
Yeah,
that's right.
So he was always meticulous about that.
And then I'm sure this picture here of him recording is, I don't know, I know you have it here, but.
It is right there.
Yeah.
It's a CD set, actually,
the
right
whole,
there.
The whole thing. And this is really cool. If you have not seen this or done this, you can put this in your car. And just as you drive around, John Colick will describe for you the town that you're going through and the brief history of the town, whether it be Demarest or Clarksville or Helen.
Yep.
You know, and that's a cool thing that you all did.
Yeah, it's the book's actually inside with four CDs.
Yeah.
Which CDs are becoming obsolete. I've got to find some 8-year-old kid to show me how to put it on a thumb drive or something. But it was for a Haberstown Electric Membership Corporation, the 75th anniversary, so we did 75 places. That's how we came up with the number.
Oh, okay.
And so it's all around Northeast Georgia in the 6 or 7 counties that they operate in. And you can pull up to, for example, the Indian Mound, and you can put the CD in the car. You can hear John's wonderful, gravelly, grandfatherly voice telling you all about that Indian Mound. It's just a wonderful thing. It's got original music by Dee Dee Volt on it. It's a really neat. I'm really, very proud of that.
Yeah, that's a great collection. And if you have not gotten it, you need to. And have not thought about it to this instant. You're right. I'm in the direct choirs.
Yeah.
Quite often, I will try to get CDs or get permission to make CDs to demonstrate different songs and stuff to my choir. But I'm having to stop do that because half of the choir doesn't have a CD player in the
choir. That's right.
We're getting too old.
I know. But that book, it's got a lot more than just about Helen. It's got other things to do in the area.
Really?
So if you pick that up and do all 75 of those places there, they'll got the White County Courthouse and the Nora Mill and just places through the Gorge, all kind of places like that.
It's great. And before we leave here today, I'm going to get you to sign one of those for me because I don't have it. But listen, I want to talk with you in just a minute about one of my favorite stories and now book that you have, Cunningham. Cunningham. Now, who else could come up with that but Emory? And if you will stick with us during the break, we're going to come back. And I want to talk with you, Emory, about Cunningham and other pigs I have known. I've never known a pig. Emory.
I've known several pigs.
Oh, good. Okay. We'll be back in just a minute. Don't go away.
Don't go away. There's more talk coming up on the Front Porch. We'll be right back.
do more, enjoy more, expect more from your internet experience. Kinetic by Windstream is delivering enhanced speed and reliability for homes and businesses around the country. We've made major investments in our network in your community. We're lighting the way to advanced capabilities and more opportunities. Stream seamlessly, surf securely, game victoriously, and connect to great offers for work or home at Windstream.com.
Well, welcome back, everyone. We are happy to be back on the front porch after several months away. But we're excited because I have one of my favorite people in the world here, Emory Jones. And I love Cunningham. What a great bumper sticker. Emory, one of your funniest and best books is your stories about Cunningham.
Yeah.
I love to read. And I want you to tell us just a little bit about your favorite pig.
Well, Cunningham, actually, the way it all happened, Bobby, was kind of accidental. I was sitting on the porch with my wife reading the paper one Saturday morning. And, you know, as we mentioned, the blotter item is right where everybody goes to read first. And then one of the blotter items was that someone had found a dead pig in their driveway over on Town Creek Road. Hmm. And I thought, man, I've got to write a column about that. Yeah. So my wife rolled her eyes as I walked up to the office, and I came back down with it. And then I read it to her, and so she kind of chuckled a little bit, which is high praise from
you. Yeah.
So I sent it to the newspaper, and it ran. And I made up this story about how it was my pig. Yeah. And it was, we were just coming back from the hog hospital in Homer where I'd taken him to get his flu shot. And the new bypass had just gone around Cleveland at that time. Yeah. So he was wanting to go by the Farmers Exchange and get some peppermint pig pellets, which he really likes. And I was in a hurry to get home, so I didn't let him in. But he jumped out, apparently, and made all this stuff up as I went. But he jumps out, and I'm sure that he'd gotten over to Town Creek and just worn himself out and had died, and I hope they gave him a proper burial. And it was just a funny story. Well, the newspaper editor, Billy Chisholm, called me the following week and said, "You've got to write another column about that pig." He said, "We had a tremendous response to that." He said,
"Really?
People calling up."
Oh, how about that?
I said, "Well, I can't, Billy. He's dead." He said, "Well, bring him back to life."
Yeah.
So I thought, how am I going to do that? So I waited a couple of weeks and I wrote another column that says, "Hey, it wasn't my pig. You know, he'd been hanging out with an old sow down at under the loading dock at the feed store." And that was led to, I started taking him on trips. And people started believing that I had a pig.
I had a pig.
And it got to where, if I like to write serious columns, and I like to write funny columns, and I never envisioned myself writing columns strictly about a pig, but all of a sudden, if I wrote anything else, I'd see them on the street, and they'd say, "I missed your pig. I want to write about the pig again." So I started getting all kind of response to it, so I kept more or less writing about the pig. I took him to Washington, D.C., I took him to Rock City. He took his pet rock, Hudson. Oh. His pet rock was named Hudson, Rock Hudson. And so we took him up to, he wanted to, his rock was a country rock, and he wanted his rock to be exposed to some city rock. So we went up to Rock City. And so we did. We had all kind of trouble. Then we had to go back because we left Hudson up there. So the next week we went back. Then we took him to the horse races, and he accidentally got on the track, but came in first. And, So all it's just a fun bunch of funny stuff,
and that's where the probably the best caricature in that book comes from, him being at the horse race.
Yeah,
the pig.
Yeah, the yeah. Pig. There's lots of and the illustrations in here. I just love the illustrations and the cover.
Yeah,
Jim Powell, Windstream's own Jim Powell illustrated this. And he did the cover, and I would send him up a story, and he'd read it, and he'd send me back an illustration of something absolutely hilarious.
Really?
His illustrations are funnier than my words.
I don't know about that, but you're right; they are funny.
Yeah,
yeah. They and you could have maybe you should do a small children coloring book.
Well, we thought about that, and somebody suggested a comic book thing. But right now, the last column I wrote about him, he was hitching a ride over on 985.
Yeah.
And he got on a livestock truck that was headed for L.A.
Oh, really?
And he's went to Hollywood, and we've seen him in a couple of movies. In the last movie, you might have seen a TV special. He was Dead Pig Number 3. And so I'm sure if he keeps working, he'll be Dead Pig Number 1 before you know.
No, so, no.
But he got a job out there on Miss Piggy's estate.
Oh, really?
Yeah, he's her gardener.
He's like almost semi-famous, or at least.
Oh, well, you know, you got to start
somewhere.
Right there.
Yeah.
But I hated to see him go out to Hollywood, but he wrote me, he had his agent write me a note to say that I was holding him back, and it was just time for him to move on.
How disappointing.
It is disappointing, but you know, he had more talent than I did, and he's just I'm not gonna hold him. I hope to get a couple of postcards from him, you know? But this is just strictly for fun. This is just to make people laugh.
Well, that's what I like. You know, that's one thing I like about reading your columns and your articles and your books. Even, you know, you did a foreword for our book on Habersham 200,
right? Yeah.
And I thought it was so interesting to read because, of course, we've gotten all of the history of White County and the separation, and your few words, the separation from Habersham County,
right.
and you learned a lot. But at the same time, you had fun doing it.
Yeah.
And I think that's great. That's something that I would certainly wish I could develop even more in the stories that I tell and write about, because you're a master at it.
Well,
what's your favorite story in Cunningham?
Oh, my goodness, the favorite story in Cunningham. Let me see. I guess the favorite story in Cunningham would have to be the time that I took him up to Rock City. I don't know why, but that one, we got two columns out of that one because we left his pet up there.
Oh, really?
And
had
then
to go back.
Yeah, then another one that's really a close second is where there was another blotter. It's based on another blotter item. A guy was had to jump up and down to prove he was not drunk.
Oh, really?
And when his pants fell down, he wasn't wearing any underwear.
Uh-oh.
And so, of course, I made that into a column about Cunningham was involved in that, and the guy who was taking the pig to the veterinarian, too, and he had a pig. I got him a girlfriend. Then there's another one I really like where there was, we started our own book club. Cunningham, a lot of book clubs up here will not allow pig in it. It's just a shame.
Really?
It's a shame.
It is.
Something needs to be addressed about that. But anyway, we were thrown out of three or four book clubs because of no pig policy.
Oh, my goodness.
So we started our own book club. It was just my cousin Wayne and Cunningham and me. But we got a guy from Atlanta to come up to speak to the book club, and we had to hold it in Wayne's muffler and repair shop. Repair shop.
Oh.
And so we... the guy just was not well received. I mean, he didn't receive it. He didn't like the location of the thing, and he was just a little too highfalutin for us. But that's a really funny story.
That's great.
A lot of them are fun. So.
Well, listen, I know that you have written a lot of books, and how many books have you written?
I don't even know. Probably 8 or 9 now, something like that.
There's the one we looked at a while ago. Several of these books. I know the Habersham EMC. You wrote that.
That's one of my favorite books. It's a story of the Habersham EMC, but it's also a story of a lot of history in there. We talked to some people that remember how to farm and everything without electricity and all that. The problem I've got is I write some serious books, The Valley Where They Danced and the Etched in Pottery books, and all I'm going to be remembered for is this pig.
Well, sometimes it's the most unlikely thing. But now, you know what, Emory, in this day and age in which we live, and I'm not going to get into it, but it's not a good time. We've got a bunch of weird stuff going on in this country, in this world, and everywhere else. It's great to be able to sit down with a book and just escape all of it for just a little while.
I had somebody tell me this was an escapist book.
Oh, did you?
Yeah, yeah.
Well, cool.
Yeah. So I don't know if that was a compliment or an insult.
Yeah. Well, listen, our time is getting away from us really quickly, and we need to take another break. But don't leave, because the best segment is yet to come. Come right back.
Don't go away. There's more talk coming up on The Front Porch. We'll be right back.
From local community events, chamber and cooking shows, to community church services, we've got something for everyone. Stay tuned to Channel 1, Kinetic TV by Windstream.
Welcome back, everyone. Yeah, Emory and I were just looking through this book. Let me just tell you that there are a lot of other great stories in this book. If you don't have this book, Emory, in a minute we're going to find out how they can get a hold of it. But I know that you have written... What some of these books? At least what, 5 or 6?
More than that. Now, when I got to 6, I decided I had to write number 7, and it was an interesting story how that happened. I write a column for a couple of magazines, Mountain Laurel Magazine and Southern Distinction Magazine, and they usually put a little blurb about me at the very end. Well, Southern Distinction had this a column, and I wrote about something or other. At the end, they had the little blurb. It said, "Emory Jones from White County." Yada, yada, yada. He has written 6 books, including zipping through Georgia, White County 101, And instead of six, they wrote sex. He has written sex books.
Like S-E-X.
S-E-X. Real typo. I mean, I've still got the thing. Where
oh, really?
Yeah. So I figured I had to write another book so that couldn't happen again. But the way I heard about this was I didn't know anything about it because you never read the little thing at the bottom.
Yeah.
Nobody had mentioned it to me, but I was speaking to a group of little ladies, and little old ladies, I guess, my friends of the library group. And at the end of my talk, I always say, are there any questions? And this little lady in the back says, Mr. Jones, or did you bring any of your sex books to sell today? Absolutely floored me. My wife's sitting over there, and she looks at me like, I'm looking at her.
So I didn't know he was doing that.
Well, after that, everywhere I went, I got a comment about that. And it changed. So I wrote this column about how that one little typo and one little three-letter word had changed my entire life.
Oh, yeah.
You know, I mean, now I'm looked at in a completely different way.
You found a whole new clientele.
Yeah. So that prompted me to write another book just to keep that from happening again. But I've written several.
Did you ever get an invitation where somebody said, Mr. Jones, would you mind coming and talking with us about your sex books?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Everywhere I went, I would, for a while there, for about 2 or 3 months after that came out, I would go into a restaurant and people would say, there he is, the sex therapist.
Well, it's funny how a pig and sex can change your life.
you just never know where life's going to take you. I mean, from one little blotter item to just...
Oh, you never know. So. Well, listen, Emory, before we go today, first of all, make sure I get to the end of time. I want people to know how they can get a hold of some of your things here. But I also wanted to talk to you about something that's really dear to both of our hearts, and that's the Hardman Farm over in Saltine, actually in the Nacoochee Valley.
Yep.
And I know that you have been associated with them a lot more than I, but I know that you have also written a play, Valley Voices. And I know that you talked with me about possibly being in it, and as much as I would like to, I think that I have all this immense talent and acting ability that would cause them to come after somebody like me. I really deep down know that the real reason that you wanted me to be a part of Valley Voices is Sarah, the car, the 1931 Model A.
No, that's not true, Bobby. No, we scouted out all the possible talent for that particular role of the farm manager, and your name kept coming up over and over, and then we found out later that you had the car.
Oh, is that what it was?
No. I was just trying to make you feel good.
I know, okay. Yeah. No, it was the car.
Well, the car helped. You know, it's just like casting anywhere else. You know, you got to have a little extra something you have to bring to the table.
There, that's right.
But you did a great job. We put on one of the scenes from that play. The play itself will tell the story of the Hardman Farm from the ancient times all the way up through, and it's an outdoor drama, all the way up through today. We'll feature a Native American telling their story of the Native Americans in here. That we'll talk about the first settlers that came in 1822. Yeah. Daniel Brown comes out. Actually, the place is all outdoors. It'll have horses in it. It'll have your car in it. It'll have black powder rifles in it. It's got a lot of excitement, and it's going to really be something. But we took one segment of that play, and we put it at last month's Harvest Moon Supper. And we just, it was kind of a trial run too, right. but you were there. I thought it went very well, the people that came.
It did go very good. And for those of you who may not know what we're talking about, Hardman Farm is over in the Nacoochee Valley, right across from the famous Indian Mound. You ask somebody, I know I work a lot in South Carolina, I work in a church in South Carolina, and you tell people about Hardman Farm over there, and they will say, well, that's interesting, where is it? And I will say, well, have you ever seen the Indian Mound going into Helen? Oh, yeah, I know where that is.
Yes.
And I say, well, it's the big mansion and farm is on the right. I don't remember. Truth of the matter is, a lot of people will come in, they're so focused on that gazebo and Mount Yona behind that they don't realize that probably one of the most interesting and historic Georgia landmarks is right there in the Hardman Farm.
Right.
And what impresses me most about that is I've been familiar with the farm really my whole lifetime. I remember my dad took me there when I was a kid, and for what reason, I don't know. My dad used to install screen windows and doors. And I remember us going and visiting that place, you know, when the Hardman family still owned it. And it was back behind the hedgerow. You didn't hardly see it. I may have paid little attention to it back in the 60s when he was doing that. But it has now become a Georgia historic site.
It's the newest one, the state's newest historic site.
And what's fascinating about it is, for those of you who have not been, is the fact when you go through the door, that house is exactly as it was back in the 1880s and 1870s and 1880s.
Yeah, so is the Indian Mound, and I wrote that book about the Indian Mound called Distant Voices.
That's right.
And we used a lot of local poets and artists that had painted it and been drawn to it, and photographers, to include their story in with the story of the Indian Mound, because it wouldn't just be pure history. But they say it's the second most recognized structure in Georgia.
Yeah.
I don't know who keeps up with those things. I don't know how they measure
it. I'd like to know what first one was.
I think it's supposed to be Stone Mountain.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and then the lighthouse people over at Hilton Head kind of claim a back and forth.
But the church.
The church.
Crescent Church. Hill,
yeah. Captain Nichols built that in the house and the gazebo.
And the gazebo, all three of them.
Right.
In the 1870s. It's a fascinating story. And so today you can go walk through that house and just kind of envelop yourself in the 1870s and 80s, because the house was whitewashed on the inside. It has never been painted to this day.
Right. It's
on the inside.
Yeah. And we have several people that are on the Friends board and Friends group that have costumes. We have spent a lot of money to get some costumes. So you can actually might meet Dr. Hardman
or even Bob Minish.
Bob Minish, the character.
Yeah.
You're going to be known as Bob Minish.
I'm going to be known as Bob Minish. That's my character. Listen, it had been a fantastic time, Emory. I'm going to tell you how to get you here every other episode, because we have so many stories to tell. But tell us really quick, if someone was interested in buying Cunningham, Helen 101, of course, we talked last time you were here about Cheever.
Yeah, Cheever is another.
And of course, the Valley Where They Dance is a play now.
Yeah.
As is
Cheever too.
And
I finally, after all these years, have a website up.
Cool.
It's emoryjones.com.
Okay.
And you can go there, and these books are over here in Cornelia, the Books of Appeal, Books of Appeal have the books, and Old Salty Store, Betty's Country Store, the Lavender Shop, Yona Mountain Book Exchange.
Okay.
So they're in a lot of local stores.
I think there may be a few over at Tocoa. You still have some books over there at Tocoa
Museum
anyway,
over there.
Great places. Time is gone. Thank you for visiting with us. We're going to be back. Thanks for being with us on the Front Porch. Hope you guys have a great day. We'll see you next time.